My loving and encouraging husband recently posted on my Facebook page an article about a study of second-born children, which I happen to be, tagging me and our second-born child, Hannah. The article was entitled, "Study Finds That Second-Born Children Are More Likely to Be Criminals," to which I replied, "Awesome. Now I know what I want to do with the rest of my life." Then my dad posted a picture of me looking like some kind of comic book criminal, dressed all in black, with the caption, "There were early tendencies," which prompted my Aunt Maggie, my dad's younger sister, to say, "Well, you were second born, Dal. I have a few stories I could tell. But you seem to have overcome those early tendencies." My second-born dad has an older sister, Kathy, and a younger sister, Margaret, whom my dad calls Marg, who was always called Aunt Marge, and now she likes to be called Maggie, which just reinforces my thought of her as wonderfully eccentric. The stories Aunt Marge likes to tell include the time my dad told her to stick her finger in the car cigarette lighter, or the time he built a fire in his bedroom closet. For those of you born after 1995, cars used to have cigarette lighters built into the dashboard. A small tube was designed to be pushed in, and then it would heat up so you could pull it out and light your cigarette or burn your little sister's finger. That is a mean thing to do, but to be fair, not out of the scope of something a big brother would try on a little sister, not necessarily criminal. At first glance, starting a fire in one's closet could be considered criminal, but let's hear the whole story. First of all, he was only 5 years old. My father's grandmother would come to visit a few weeks every year, and during one visit she complained that there seemed to be a chill in the house. So my 5-year-old dad just wanted to help. He went to his room, built a small fire in his closet, came downstairs and told his mother, "Now Grandma will not be cold." Fortunately, his mother did not leave it there, questioned him further, and a disaster was averted. My dad recalls that those are the only 2 times he ever remembers seeing his mother angry. I vaguely remember my grandmother being angry with my brother Dan once. Mostly I remember her to be cheerful and kind. My mother always said she was a saint. I never exactly understood what she meant by that, but I think it had something to do with my grandfather. She was a no-nonsense, common-sense kind of person. Once when we were having a picnic on the beach and a seagull flew over and pooped right into her coleslaw, she just pushed it aside and kept eating, unfazed. She was always busy, working away with this happy little whispery whistle, with a gentle smile and ready to share one of her tongue twisters. Theophilus Thistle, the successful thistle sifter, in sifting a sieve full of unsifted thistles, thrust 3,000 thistles through the thick of his thumb. If Theophilus Thistle, the successful thistle sifter, can thrust 3,000 thistles through the thick of his thumb, see that thou, in sifting a sieve full of unsifted thistles, thrust not 3,000 thistles through the thick of thy thumb. Success to the successful thistle sifter. So Grandma does it a little better. I tried, Grandma.
Theophilus Thistle, the successful thistle sifter, in sifting a sieve full of unsifted thistles, thrust 3,000 thistles through the thick of his thumb. Now, if Theophilus Thistle, the successful thistle sifter, in sifting a sieve full of unsifted thistles, thrust 3,000 thistles through the thick of his thumb, see that thou, in sifting a sieve full of unsifted thistles, thrust not 3,000 thistles through the
thick of thy thumb. Success to the successful thistle sifter. My grandpa, on the other hand, was a curmudgeon. I thought of him as a lovable curmudgeon and an absolute original. He was always busy, too, fixing things, tinkering with old radios or coffee makers. He saved everything. His workshop was full of balls of twine, little bits of string and wire, baby food jars full of buttons and screws and nails and duct tape. He always had duct tape. He would talk about living through the Depression, about people I didn't know with names like Ed Monk. I would get lectured for leaving milk in my cereal bowl. I would have been happy for that milk. I had to put water on my cereal. He had a short temper and would sometimes leave the room in a huff over one thing or another, muttering to himself about noisy kids mumbling about his chair and the house and dishes getting in the way. But he always had an odd and wonderful sense of humor, too. He was bald, so it was important to protect his head from the sun. Anything available would be used as a sunshield. He would tie knots in the four corners of a handkerchief, if a hat was not handy, or plop a dish towel over his head. Grandpa was my go-to guy at family gatherings. I would follow him around, and he would show me what he was working on and tell me long stories about relatives I never met. I have three cousins on my dad's side of the family. My cousin Stephanie and Aunt Marge always seemed to be off on some kind of adventure, and we didn't see them often. Aunt Marge was my cool aunt. I always thought her adventures sounded so exotic. She would probably have a good chuckle over that idea. I still think she is pretty cool, the kind of person who makes friends wherever she goes, friendly and kind with an easy laugh. She was a librarian and would send us the most wonderful books, not just a book on your birthday. She would send off a book at any time for no reason other than it was a good book and she thought you would like it. My other two cousins, Liz and John, belonged to my Aunt Kathy and Uncle Dave, two people who hold a very special place in my heart. My Aunt Kathy, a wonderful combination of my grandparents, always busy with the same happy, whispery whistle like my grandmother, the same cheerful and kind presence. It makes me happy. She sent me care packages of cookies and other goodies all through my college years. Then she did the same for my girls as they went off to college. And I know my Aunt Kathy prays for me and my family every day. She is the kind of person who makes you feel well-loved. Now my Uncle Dave. Uncle Dave is a character of the best kind, full of the worst jokes you have ever heard, who every child knows as the man with the handkerchief mouse. He has a special way of folding his handkerchief into a little mouse that he would make jump from his hand into yours, or as you pet the little mouse on the head, it would jump out of his hand right at you. I'll have to ask him someday how many handkerchiefs he goes through in a year. Uncle Dave was my other go-to guy at family gatherings. John was about the same age as my younger brother Dan. Liz was a year older than me and a year younger than my older sister Lisa, and because it's way cooler to hang out with someone older than you, Liz and Lisa spent most of their time trying to avoid me. Grandpa or Uncle Dave were more fun anyway. Uncle Dave was always on my side. On hikes, he would sidle up next to me like he had this great secret and open his hand to reveal a handful of raspberries or blackberries he had found on the trail just for me. I always felt like that was his way of making up for me being the odd man out. My Uncle Dave loves to tell the story about taking all of us kids fishing, and I was the only one who caught any fish. The others would put their line in and wait and never get a bite. Then you would throw yours in and right away pull out another fish. You were having so much fun catching fish after fish. I don't actually remember this happening, but he loves to tell me this story, which makes me smile because he took so much joy in my success. Like I said, he was always on my side. In later years, when my daughter Hannah, who struggles with some physical challenges, would be straggling along behind everyone else, guess who was right back there with her? Yep, Uncle Dave. In the early years, family gatherings often took place at Bel Air campgrounds. I have no idea where Bel Air campground is located. I was at that age when you get in the car, fall asleep, and wake up in a new location. I do know that the campground was managed by my great Aunt Helen. I don't know much about my Aunt Helen, other than she was a miniature version of my grandmother. The campground had a softball field that would draw a crowd to watch the games. Those were exciting times. Interesting people would show up at the campground, people on motorcycles with tattoos, and men with crazy wax mustaches, and the promise of a free bag of popcorn. And in my young life, it was only ever a promise, never a reality. We knew that if a foul ball or a home run was hit over the fence, we could retrieve the ball and bring it to the candy shop for a free bag of popcorn. There were never enough games or enough home runs for me to achieve my goal. But that didn't stop me from hanging around. Maybe I'd get to see that guy with the funny mustache again. There are many fun pictures from this time. One of a swan attacking my Uncle Dave, which prompts me to tell everyone, every time I see a swan, that swans may be beautiful, but they are mean. Another is a series of pictures of my brother Dan and my cousin John that we love to give them a hard time about. The first picture is of the two of them pumping water into a bucket from a water pump. The next is the two of them peeing into the said bucket, and the next is them carrying the bucket back to the campsite. Now John swears up and down that he was only watching Dan pee into the bucket and not participating. And I hate to admit it, but on closer inspection of the picture, I think he might be right. I'm glad my dad was a good photographer. He got some good shots. Well, that's the cast of characters on my dad's side of the family. It's a pretty good bunch. My cousin Liz freely admits that she and my sister Lisa were pretty mean to me when we were kids. And I do remember feeling lonely and left out sometimes. But mostly I remember the good things. I'm pretty sure there's no lasting damage. Although I'm not sure my sister Lisa still doesn't try to avoid me now and then.